Hello, I'm Dr. Nagaraj Puttaswamy. Today we are talking about laparoscopic hernia surgeries. Laparoscopically, we can probably treat all types of hernia, say umbilical hernia, incisional hernias, inguinal hernias, Spigelian hernias, diaphragmatic hernias, all these hernias can be treated laparoscopically. See, the techniques are a little different from each other. Initially, when we started, it was very easy and convenient procedure for a laparoscopic umbilical hernia to be done, where we were doing onlay mesh. That is, the mesh was put inside the abdominal cavity. IPOM, intraperitoneal onlay mesh, were laid, and it was very, very convenient and easy. Over a period of time, we found that some amount of adhesions were trying to happen, and the mesh evolved. Mesh evolved in the sense, a simple polypropylene mesh which was tried to use, it was attracting a lot of adhesions between the bowel structures. So we try to evolve, or the manufacturers try to make changes by getting dual meshes which didn't allow adhesions to happen. So IPOM was still fine. Then next came is IPOM Plus. IPOM Plus is intraperitoneal onlay mesh along with the repair of the hernial rent. Initially, repairing and suturing were challenging and difficult in the learning period in the year maybe 1999-98 when I started laparoscopic surgery. It was a little difficult to do intraoperative suturing and knotting. So later on, IPOM Plus came up. It was relatively easy. Now what we are trying to do is abdominal wall repair. That is, preperitoneally we place the mesh, we do the resection of the peritoneum and put the mesh in front of the peritoneum so that the complication and adhesion concepts become almost negligible or zero. So the outcome of the surgical procedure becomes that much very, very convenient. And inguinal hernias, what we try and do is, there are mainly two types of procedure, and the third one is evolving and it is still good. The one which is very convenient and easy is TAPP, Transabdominal Preperitoneal Repairs. That is a relatively easy and convenient surgical procedure. And the next one is TEP, that is Totally Extraperitoneal Repair. Now, there is one more procedure, that is the extension of TEP, that is called Extended Trans Total Extraperitoneal Repair, where the techniques are little different from each other. But end of the day, whatever said and done, what we are trying to do is repair the hernial rent, enhance the strength of the abdominal wall so that there is no possibility of a recurrence in the days to come. See, in inguinal hernias, what we try and do is we will try to cover not just the inguinal orifices, that is the direct and the indirect orifice, we try to cover the femoral orifice and also the obturator orifice. These are potential three sites of inguinal hernia regions in the pelvic hernias. So, all three sites are covered in whether we do TAPP or TEP or extended TEP. All these conditions will help us to prevent big time recurrences of groin hernias. In case of incisional hernias, again the technique becomes little different than the IPOM which I try to mention related to umbilical hernia. Say where there the incision which is relatively big sometimes and bossulation of the hernial site is obvious for the patient, we try to do it very comfortably, repair the incisional hernia by non-absorbable sutures and later on place the mesh on top of that, or maybe do the dissection of the peritoneum and place it in front of the peritoneum. These are multiple different types, and parallelly we try to see Spigelian hernias or lateral hernias, lumbar hernias, and also a lower incisional, only a small segment of the incision would have given way. All these types of complex hernias we would generally see. But diaphragmatic hernia in newborns or young patients we try and see. But many a times we just try to repair, because over a period of time the muscle are strong enough to maintain. But if we are trying to repair diaphragmatic hernias in adult, we invariably try and use mesh there as well. One more common hernia is what we hear, or maybe patients straight away come up with, hiatus hernia. Hiatus hernia is the esophagus of the stomach trying to slide or go into the thoracic cavity. So when the intra-abdominal pressure for whatever reason is high, the stomach and the esophagus try to migrate upwards towards the thorax. So what we try and do there is we try to get the esophagus and the stomach back into the abdominal cavity. Maybe we'll repair the crosses of the diaphragm, that is the right and left crura are there. They will be repaired with non-absorbable suture. Not many times we try and use meshes, but if the crust strength is very weak, we try and reinforce with the help of a Teflon mesh. And later on, we will try and do a wrapping of the stomach around the lower end of esophagus, that is partial or full, nice and fundoplication we call, partial or total wrapping we can do, and that will help us to fix the reflux and a significant amount of regurgitation for a patient who is suffering from long time. These are common surgical procedures we try and execute through laparoscopic. See, should there be a use of mesh in laparoscopic surgery for repairing hernia is one more common question which we try and come across. So, meshes are vital. See, hernia happens just because there is significant amount of lax abdominal wall or the muscle strength is not great. So, what the mesh will do when we try and implant there is it has multiple pores. It will allow lot of fibrin materials to grow in, lot of collagen structures to get in there, and then it will strengthen. So, it is not that the mesh will hold hernia to recur, it is the growth of protein material and muscle fibers or the fibrous tissue which will grow in between the pores of the mesh that will help by strengthening the abdominal wall so that there is almost no recurrence following a hernia surgery. See, we were in a period where hernias were operated by the conventional method, open surgeries, and absorbable sutures were used. And later on, significant possibility of recurrence were there. But with us, we have evolved so much that once we find a hernia, if it is operated once, it should never come back. And if it is coming back, probably there is problem from the patient end and also the technical end. So, whether we have used the mesh or not used the mesh, or maybe the patient has some internal issues where the patient is not even producing collagen. So, a deficient patient with significant amount of collagen protein also has a possibility where the hernia comes back often. Should we compare laparoscopic hernia with open hernia? Yes, of course, we have evolved and we have been trained to do laparoscopic surgery and also open surgery. So, but open surgery was what we were taught about when we were postgraduates, and that we have learnt how to do it laparoscopically. But I will make it more simpler. So, it's it's something like laparoscopic surgery is like flying if you are travelling for a long distance. So, open surgery is like travelling through train or on the road. So, this is main difference what I can tell. See, if we are flying, you can save time. That is the quick recovery and almost no pain and discomfort is there. PD recovery helps in to get back to normal activity. Probably full range of activity an individual can do. So, I mean to tell, a sportsman or an athlete or a gymnast can definitely undergo laparoscopic surgery and perform the fullest of full range of physical movements after laparoscopic surgery, which is not the thing in open surgery. After open surgery, we try to ask the patient to be restrictive, but not in laparoscopic surgery. And at the same time, the cost is almost not much different. It is almost the same. How many days that they stay, and the patient stays for a day? Maybe sometimes a daycare. Morning, if I operate, patient is ready to leave the hospital on the same day in laparoscopic surgery procedure, when compared to open surgery, where the patient needs to stay back for 2-3 days, or if it is an incisional hernia, the patient may have to stay for a week. Incisional hernia, if it is done laparoscopically, patient can do leave the hospital in 1 or 2 days. And what is the possibility of infection? Almost zero. What is the amount of blood loss laparoscopically? Almost zero. So, these are the huge benefits. It will score very, very high. Now, maybe say 10 to 90% difference is there when compared to open surgery and laparoscopic surgery. Related to inguinal hernias, there are many a times bilateral inguinal hernias. Can we operate bilateral inguinal hernias in the same setting? Yes, of course. We can do inguinal hernias both sides. Even if it is one side it is recurrent and a new opposite side is there, we can definitely do. We can even combine umbilical hernia, bilateral inguinal hernia together. But many a times what I practice is, say if there is an infective condition, say for example acute appendicitis, acute cholecystitis, where the patient has to undergo the primary surgery of that condition, but the same patient as a inguinal hernia or an umbilical hernia, should we combine that? I usually try and tell that it is not a very good idea to combine an infective surgical condition along with a mesh repair, because there will be a high possibility of infection following a mesh placement, because it is a foreign body, of course, though it is an inert material, will probably catch up infection, and it will land up in a bigger difficulty if you try and combine infective cases with a hernia surgical procedure. But bilateral inguinal hernia or an umbilical hernia with an inguinal hernia or recurrent hernias, all these can be done laparoscopically very conveniently and safely. Related to laparoscopic surgery and inguinal hernias, maybe I was one of the surgeons who started to do laparoscopic surgical procedures for inguinal hernias in Bangalore from the year maybe 2001-2. From then, probably till now, we would have completed more than 5,500 to 6,000 different types of hernias till date. Unfortunately, we have found very minimal difficulties and recurrences, almost nothing, and complex or issues related to laparoscopic surgical procedures on hernias are almost not there in our series of hernia surgeries. I am proud on that.